Getting Real 3. Like to welcome Wisconsin. Tonight we have a very special guest. Every lecture is a special guest because we have the baddest lecturers, the baddest speakers. Today we are going to have Jen Johnson present on Hip Hop Debate, Remixing Literacies and Textual Possibilities for the 21st Century Classroom. Jen Johnson is the founder and director of the Columbia Debate Institute, a six-week culturally relevant summer camp for high school students throughout New York City. She is a PhD student in the English Ed Department at Teachers College and a graduate fellow from the Institute for Urban and Minority Education and the Hip Hop Education Center. She is also an adjunct professor of literacy at Manhattanville College, and she is she is also the former director of the Seattle Debate Foundation, founder and director of the Seattle Debate Institute at the University of Washington. She has taught summer debate around the country at Stanford, Bates College, University of Maryland, College Park, University of California, et cetera, et cetera. Jen holds a Master in Arts in Media, Culture and Communication, and a Bachelor's in Ethnic Studies from the University of California. Her research and work is dedicated to the economic, political, cultural, and social justice and support of our young leaders through debate, education, and hip-hop culture. Sorry for this horrible introduction, but please welcome Jen Johnson.
Welcome, everyone. I'm so happy to be here and to share with everyone and to also have some of our crew with us. And so this is Hip Hop Debate, and to your left, my right, we have Tyler Prodigy Anderson from Acorn Community High School. Give it up. And to your right, my left, is Shamela Jeffers, also from Acorn Community High School. And they will be blessing our space and being a part of the dialogue as well. And so when we come to questions and answers, please feel free to direct some questions to our young leaders and scholars as well. And but first, to kind of set us up and to bless us, we have Prodigy, who will start us out and give us the overview for today.
I am a griot. Here in Africa, I use my rhymes to tell a story, not for the fame and never for the glory. History written by the oppressors forever phony, so I take their words and spit them back on lone beats. Incorporating our cultures, the philosophy that surrounds me, I recite these words to a world that has drowned me. And experiences that shape me, remake me, and sometimes blind me, but I shed no tears, only move my feet, please mind me. In hindsight, I've never seen myself write a word, but now words flow through my hands like flying birds. This is literally the first time since I spoke orally in the town. I come from a land where we work instead of clown, not colonize others like those who are indebted to our frowns and try to dip me in slave labors with our body in dead mounds. Even though I enjoy my craft, there's a larger meaning to my rhyme and draft, for serving a culture not for those who are daft and memorize the lines to support the new staff. They name me a historian, a storyteller, Mr. Griot, traveling the lands from West Africa to Rio, reciting my journey in epics sometimes with keynotes. Generation to generation, our tongues are so lethal, cause words are unique while hands are to all people. I've been around long in the writings before the fighting, and still survive today, even if you only see me in writing. I'm a griot.
And Tala is, Prodigy is a griot. And one thing, I saw this before I came here today. He shared this because he just recently wrote this piece. When did you write it?
1 o'clock in the morning.
1 o'clock in the morning. Naturally, as an artist and a scholar and a leader, And I was really struck by how it really tied in to what we were going to talk about today together. And that he posits this counter-hegemonic history and positionality, and incorporating and acknowledging and paying tribute to his own, his community, and his ancestors' cultural wealth. And his lyrical prowess and all these literary devices that we hold so dear in the academy just flow through his piece. And it's more than just this craft, he says. Like, he's honoring so much, and there's so much heart and feeling in it. And it's for the purpose of cultural preservation and for the future, for new steps. And I hope that this isn't making you uncomfortable, me telling you all this, because it's just like, I haven't even told you this before you got here. But, you know, Mr. Griot, the prodigy, he demonstrates our history, this geographical and historical journey, fighting for unity, and reminding us, like Langston Hughes, that the rivers run deep. And before this event, too, one other thing I want to tell you is that he was mixing up on GarageBand a piece, some music for Shamela to use later on, and it was amazing, because I was like, oh, we could just cue up the song. So, well, I can just cut this real quick, all the different pieces. So got GarageBand up, and I don't know if anyone saw him up here with the headphones on, listening to the piece, but he was mixing it up too. And that's just kind of a clip shot, an overview of what we're about to do this evening and what we're about to talk about. So again, give it up. And this is also, and we just came from debate meeting to down at Crown Heights, so we had a long day. They had school all day, and a lot of new debaters over there. And today, this is also in honor of powerful readers, writers, thinkers, creators, and change makers, our young scholars and leaders, demonstrating their powerful literacies and creative remixes. And I have to give a shout out to Team Revolution, which is the team that we've all created. A smooth team. And that in this particular session today, we're talking about remixing literacies, like through hip-hop debate, and seeing all these different textual possibilities for the 21st century classroom. And the reason why it's all jumbled up here on the screen is because that's the journey we're going to take first. Is first look at the 21st century classroom, what does it look like, then go through literacies, and then do about what's the remix, what's hip-hop to us, and the way in which we're defining it, because that's important as well, then to debate, and then why hip-hop debate, and why those possibilities. All right. So, I added this after hearing from Dr. Morell last week, too, because I think that it's really important that in the 21st century, hello, welcome, 21st century classroom, 21st century period, stakes is high. They've been high, they be high, right? This is De La. When was De La, this album? Anyone?
96.
Okay. Stakes are still very high. And let's just not forget that they're incredibly high. Did I do that wrong? I'm using this new mouse, so bear with me. And I say that just because I was inspired, as well as some of our other debaters were inspired by Gore Vidal's title of his book. And I say, let's just not forget, because this book is entitled Gore Vidal, Imperial America. And the very bottom, you can't see it very well, but it says on the actual book, but it says Reflections on the United States of Amnesia. Because oftentimes we forget certain things. And so one of the reasons why I'll bring back other workshops today is because I think it's important for us not to forget. And that's why I wanted to bring in some of the things that Dr. Morell posed last week, too, and that we must remember our global links, too, as Marlon pointed out when he presented to us, like the connections between Mr. Devious and Huey P., Mr. Devious being in Africa, right? Huey P. being in our history. And hip-hop is a vehicle for critical thought. But when we met last week, some of the things that really struck me too was just thinking about the reality that our 21st century classrooms, the American high schools, being toxic. And it really just spoke and struck a chord to me. And because some of the things that Dr. Moreau was saying was that 99% of young people make it into high school, but for people of color, only 1 out of 2 make it out in 4 years. And less than 1 in 10 are college ready. And that some of the importance of this is that the lifespan of a high school graduate, he said, was that it actually increases by 10 years. And you can correct me if I'm wrong on any of this, but I was just really struck by it. And then he also said that not only are there's that indicator, right, but also in terms of the economic growth, if you're the economist, if you want to think about how does this help our economy, that trillions of dollars will be put back into the economy, 127,000 per student in our cities and neighborhoods, if we actually cut that dropout rate by half. So these are some of the motivations behind the work that I do as well. And part of it comes from a lot of other things, but I wanted to at least remember and not have amnesia. And that despite that these harms, or as we call them in debate, part of the roots of this, and I wanted to get some Roots album covers from Things Fall Apart, actually, and for some reason it wasn't working. Because I thought that would be really perfect here, because they had 4, 5 different album covers for Things Fall Apart, and they're all just heart-wrenching. And those things haven't changed. And part of what we learned last night is that in terms of high school, that we have these ignored goals and visions and aspirations of all of our young leaders and scholars. And that it's not for lack of interest in being a scholar or performing well in school, but rather because of an experience within schools that's a problem, of feeling alienated, or the way in which our young people are represented in the media, or by educational rhetoric, and as deficits, right, the deficit type of thinking, and that it's not that our young leaders and scholars are deficits, but rather that there is a systematic failure, a deficit in our system, in our institutions, by policymakers, media, educational reform, high-stakes testing institutions, an antiquated educational system. Sorry, Madison, I realize the camera's right there. I apologize, not looking at you as well. The antiquated educational system that still reflects this 19th century industrial economy, right, where we're no longer this industrial economy that's supposed to prepare our students to be factory workers, to obey, to speak when spoken to, stand in line, jump at the bell, get to where you're going, regurgitate the mix that's been handed, and never the remix. And that to just kind of absorb a Eurocentric, or as bell hooks likes to talk about it, a white supremacist, capitalist, patriarchal, heteronormative society, cultural values, and habits of mind. She says that in a few different books. And see, I see Shamela nodding her head, because clearly all our young people are avid readers and avid thinkers. Yet it's ignored. And what we need is a different mirror. And I quote Ronald Takaki at length here, because it's really struck me when I was an undergraduate at UC Berkeley.
Go Bears!
Go Bears! Right. and this is part of this incredible story, this multicultural America, right? Trying to paint a picture for us so we don't have the amnesia. But he says, but what is needed in our own perplexing times is not so much a distant mirror as one that is different. While the study of the past can provide collective self-knowledge, it also reflects the scholar's particular perspectives or view of the world. What happens when historians leave out many of America's peoples? As Prodigy, the griot, is telling us. What happens, to borrow the words of Adrienne Rich, when someone with the authority of a teacher describes our society and, quote, you are not in it, end quote. Such an experience can be disorienting, open quote, a moment of psychic disequilibrium, as if you looked into a mirror and saw nothing, end quote. That just always struck me. What happens if you look into the mirror and you don't see yourself? And I think that part of this is that we have this need in our society to have a different mirror. And that to believe in our students, our young leaders and scholars, and their excellence, their cultural worth, funds of knowledge, as Gonzalez and Moll, and I'm definitely drawing upon a lot of individuals, and to meet students where they're at. When Dr. Gloria Letson Billings jumped off this entire series, she said we need to meet students where they are. It's important. And that we come together and meet each other. And a lot of hip-hop heads have said this as well, and hip-hop educators, that we need to do all these things. And that the other thing that kind of struck me too was that I was on the train on my way to Acorn today, and there was a trio of men, of young Black men, and they were playing Latin drums and African drums, and it was beautiful. And at the end, of course, they said, you know, if you want to contribute and support, go ahead. But also, you know, we could really just use words of encouragement. And I thought that, yes, that's absolutely important too, that we not only believe, but we also are encouraging as well, and find ways to do that. And that's not just, you know, good job here, good job there, but challenging, having an invested interest. And so that we can create this sense of community, of belonging, and so that people can feel like we're attached, we're connected. I'm using this, so I don't remember. And the next thing too is that, this is not the 19th century. In order to get to the 21st century, we have to go through this. This is not the 19th century. Post-industrial? Yeah, yes. These deficit models that we have. Stop being creative. Just do test. Get those scores up. And that this concern from many educators is that teaching the test is not a matter of teaching our students to be global citizens who can produce new knowledge that's transformative. Where in a lot of students whom I teach at Manhattanville, they're worried about even teaching their literature course because of the tests and the shifting, that they have to only focus on nonfiction and literature. And my argument has been that we can do both. We can do all these things. We can answer these critiques and move into this 21st century in a real sense, which is characterized by this globalizing world. And I say globalizing because some places are still left off the map, right? But when we say globalizing, we might think of neocolonialism or unfettered market capitalism, but also this compression of space and time through a digital reality. Two. And then we have our 21st century crises. That again, the stakes is high. But our digital connections and being in the 21st century and hip-hop is giving me inspiration and grounding and anchoring, because I can talk to Roche in South Africa and collaborate with him and talk to him. Martha's nodding her head because we know each other. We all know each other as a hip-hop family, that we can talk with one another on Skype or through email or all sorts of different ways. It was MySpace when we first connected. I know, right? When we first connected. Okay, so things change, right? That's the nature of our globalizing world. But then we can also link our struggles together. And that students can lean voices of suppression and political disenfranchisement with those in Egypt, or Burma, or Pakistan, or Maori peoples, or Ghetto Youth Uprising in Port Elizabeth Township, or Rio. And that's what I think is so incredible, that we can do that. And one thing about that as well is that we have new 21st century students, and we're not catching up the pace. We're not seeing that our students are avid readers, writers, and speakers, and digital griots. And digital griots is the title of Adam Banks' book, which that's a good title for a book. Just FYI, right? And that our students are making videos and documenting history and creative in new ways. And the use of cell phones and online magazines, coupled with Hip Hop Congress and all this movement that was happening around the Oscar Grant shooting by BART police, the Bay Area Rapid Transit, for those of you who aren't familiar with the Bay. It was unbelievable, and the significance of social networking for movements too, from the Arab Spring, and hip hop is there too, right? Digital networking and hip hop with Arab Spring to Occupy Wall Street or Occupy the Hood to massive immigration demonstrations in 2006. And that's how word was gotten out. And I hear our young debaters talk about this a lot, that's our glue. Tyler's talked about this a lot, drawing from Guillermo Martinez. I always mess up the first name.
Guillermo Martinez, Roman
Brothers. There we go, right? That's the glue that holds social movements together. And it's also a reflection of our increasing diversity, the texture and richness in our, and I can just change the slides right now. Oh, it's okay, don't worry. This is a reflection of this increasing diversity, texture, and richness in our languages and cultures. Resistance, sometimes acquiescence, and sometimes disengagement, but also original knowledge production in myriad textual forms, which gets us to new literacies. And what we mean by literacies, multiple different things. And cultural and linguistic diversity, and I put this here, parental advisory, it says, I don't know if you can see, it says some strong language and powerful visionaries. That was something that we put on our label in Seattle when our students, Hip Hop Debate students, put out an album. They used this and flipped the parental advisory and said that we have strong language. Strong language meaning it will move you, right, to want to make a difference. And we're powerful visionaries. So watch out. Advisory, or it's like a PSA. And that I also think about the next, thinking about this too, and so I kind of went through all those different types of, you know, many different forms of literacies, and when I went through the digital reality, and there's so many more, and that's, you know, to even cover, but to explain what I mean by the remix, right, by remixing literacies. Remixing, like the goal of remixing my head is like the DJ scratch. It's interruption of bankrupt and elite thinking, an interrogation of our historical amnesia. Perhaps it's a communal counter memory of sampling, reclaiming space, reclaiming histories, a counter hegemonic history, and narratives also of the present day. To unveil, reveal. The remix is creative, productive, it's producing its knowledge. It helps us tap into the fifth element, the knowledge of self. Often ignored, suppressed by dominant class culture, in the same way that our pioneers are slowly erased from what many call hip hop. Is this, am I, were you good? You good here? Okay. And then when we think about, so and we're remixing possibilities, right? Expanding, because as the world changes, we change. And as we have new generations come up, I'm learning something new every day, and I love it. And all of our colleagues in the exchanges, you know, Danielle, I love chopping it up with you, as well as your daughter, Naomi, right? That it's generational, right? And I would be remiss not to say that I wouldn't be here sitting in front of you had it not been for Martha Diaz and the reality of hip-hop. The hip-hop connects us. And there's a reason why hip-hop came into debate as well. And when I talk about hip-hop here, I'm not talking about it as an industry, just as an industry. Certainly, there's an industry, absolutely, as well. It also has this rich history, heroes and heroes, heroines, as some people like to say, who are recognizing and speaking back to conditions of oppression, marginalization, joblessness, homelessness, and also the alienated education that I first talked about. And speaking back to hostile public spaces, reclaiming public spaces, highlighting political disenfranchisement, at the same time building community, flipping education, creating new forms of education, and articulating new visions for a different world that's more just and equitable, more loving, compassionate. And so hip-hop, this is just to give you a little, this on the left, these are young people. They were featured in Newsweek magazine from hip hop debate work that they did in the south end of Seattle. And then this slide over here, Madison, the Teen Revolution. That's a graffiti wall in Canarsie. And it's a beautiful graffiti wall in Canarsie, Brooklyn. And I don't know if you can tell, but where my cursor is, there's a little icon here that says Team Revolution. So when I say Team Revolution, that's where we got it. Earth's on this wall. So debate. I know, sometimes you go all the way over here and then you come back here and you tell us you're doing this. So, okay, I'm trying to. So debate. I put this quote here because debate is something that's been around for a long time, dating back to early literary societies. And here was a quote that just always really struck me by Malcolm X. You know, standing up there, the faces looking at me, the things in my head coming out of my mouth, while my brain searched for the next best thing to follow what I was saying. And if I could sway them to my side by handling it right, then I won the debate. Once my feet got wet, I was gone on a debate. And when he was debating in prisons, he whooped Harvard. And did so much work around debate. Welcome. And so debate though. What it is now, and I put Urban Debate Leagues, but before I even read the slides, it's a competitive activity, it's a sport of the mind, right? Competitive academic policy debate, and it is it's national, interscholastic, and it's, you know, a sport of the mind, where nearly every weekend we have people who are pouring into classrooms to engage in this rigorous intellectual battle over ways to address pressing problems in the world. And the Urban Debate Leagues, they emerged as this national education reform movement designed to address the exponential growth in the achievement disparities between predominantly white, suburban, and affluent schools.
Like this one.
Hey, you know what? Hey. All good. And they're poor. That's one thing about debate, right? Is that it's lovely to be able to, and hip hop, right? That we need to call it out. It shouldn't just be like, it just, that's why it feels so strange sometimes, the silence and just like my voice reverberating the walls. And that we had this disparity between affluent, suburban, predominantly white schools and then their poor, low-income public school counterparts. And they were serving a disproportionately number of black and brown students. Mm-hmm. And then we had tax revolts of the late 70s, end of the 70s, early 80s, debate programs in these public schools vanished. So in 1985, Melissa Maxie Wade, out of Emory University, she decided to start these leagues. And George Soros picked it up, started funding a bunch of them to make sure that they exist around the country. So they now exist in 24 leagues. And what happens in doing it, in this process, is that our students are supposed to address this with these most pressing issues of our world. So things that we just laid out, right? And they have to do an incredible amount of research for one topic per year. And a lot of reading, thinking, and writing to compete in 90-minute rounds, debate rounds. Evidence-based, generally. All evidence-based. You'll understand the laugh a little bit. And it's not surprising that the leagues are credited with improving test scores, grades, reading comprehension, critical thinking skills, reducing achievement gaps between population, reducing discipline referrals, promoting college attendance. I'm going back to the other slide because the way that they're taught is too, is like get into college. Consider this number one gold star to get into college. John Sexton, the president of NYU, former dean of the law school, said that if you participate in policy debate, then you should be able to skip your first 4 years of undergrad and go straight to law school. That's deep. And then Professor Min Luong at Yale University, he talks about this direct pipeline between debate and power in this country, which is really interesting. And he says the vast majority of people in Congress have a speech and debate background. And he surveyed executives, nonprofit leaders, and lawyers, and what he found out was that they attributed their success in life not to just their education, not to just who they knew, although I have a little caveat to that, but to debate. Their participation in speech and debate. Not just debate, the speech, which could be competitive drama events. So I want to just make sure that that's also clear and not misquote him. And then Henry Drew also wrote and about the significance of urban debate leagues and that they might actually be able to reinvigorate our democratic society, create a radical democracy. And the urban debate leagues and their scholarships. People get to travel to national tournaments. Yale, we went to already this year. Georgetown. We're going to go to Harvard this year as well. We travel to Ivy League institutions. We're at Columbia right now, even though this isn't a great tournament, although we had one earlier in the year, and we had a huge institute. And we'll talk a little bit about that as well. And there's awards, and it becomes particularly important for resume building, especially when you have a school that might have a valedictorian who doesn't get into any schools, which we've seen. And that's craziness. And additionally, in 2009, there's a report done, and it's published in the Journal of Negro Education, and it spans 1997 to 2006. And the report follows 450 African-American male debaters in Chicago Urban Debate League. Findings are that debaters are 70% more likely to graduate, 3 times less likely to drop out, more likely to score at or above the ACT benchmarks for college readiness in English and reading compared to those who do not debate. And when we're struggling with figuring out what to do with our dropout rates, or with getting people ready to actually meet certain type of benchmarks, that's fairly significant. there's an issue. And traditional debate shortfalls.
Yes,
clearly well-versed in the literature up here. According to a 2001 study, starts all the way back then, high school policy debate, by sociologist and ethnographer Gary Fine, even with the advent of UDLs, urban debate leagues, aimed to increase black and brown students in debate, few actually compete in relation to the overall representation in their respective schools. And among those who do, even fewer advance into the upper echelons of the activity where advancing to elimination rounds, like the Sweet 16 or something like that, really means more than just trophies. It means meeting college recruiters. It means winning scholarships. It means networking with future employers and power brokers like lawyers, politicians, and other dignitaries. It's huge. Similar to achieving success in compulsory education, which is often predicated off of a student's ability to conform to dominant class cultural norms and linguistic practices, success at these tournaments is strongly contingent, traditionally, upon a student's ability to adapt to a particular set of linguistic practices, ideologies, and cultural norms. At a typical national tournament, students dressed in suits and ties spew technical jargon at warp speed, like this well-debated topic that often has no relevance to the Levite, right? Okay, but actually, that was really slow, but it actually can be really fun, and just, you know, even if you're hip-hop, doesn't mean you can't do that fast, right? So, anyways, but the problem is that oftentimes the issues that are discussed have little to no relevance to the lived realities of black or brown youth residing in poor urban areas, or working-class youth, or poor youth in rural areas. The topic last year, for example, although Emden just walked in, and so he actually is an example of how this can change a little bit. But the 2011, explain that, national policy debate topic was that the United States federal government should explore developed space beyond the mesosphere. Now, if your school doesn't even have a science classroom, this may be difficult to even comprehend. Or if all of a sudden you're worried about how you're going to get home, is it going to be safe, or the light's going to be on, or you're going to be safe from police, or whatever, with enough money, how is this as relevant? But it doesn't mean that we have to have an either-or reality, because we should be able to make sure that our schools and our students are able to explore and think about exploring and developing space beyond the mesosphere, but also thinking about what are the ramifications of that as well for colonization, or anything, or what are the trade-offs financially. And so, at the same time, other scholars advocated for culturally relevant education, an increasing number of coaches, debaters, and researchers are pointing to these norms and procedures as creating barriers to the recruitment, retention, and academic success of low-income debaters of color, especially African Americans. According to Dr. Reed Brinkley, who taught her this summer, quote, those with social power within the debate community are able to produce what is determined legitimate knowledge. This is also something that Shamela quotes in her debate case. And so who controls what is legitimate knowledge matters. And what type of styles are allowed? Is your culture allowed in the classroom? Do we have a different mirror? Can our students look into the mirror and see themselves? Can they have their cultures? And also, be scientists. Be all these things, brilliant philosophers and theorists. So that's why we started Hip Hop Debate in Seattle, because we had a lot of people who were saying that we can do this differently. We are griots. Yes, we are, and we're hip hop, with European roots, with Creole roots, with African roots, and Latin roots, and we can have all those things together and be powerful orators. And we can persuade, and we can research, and we can create new knowledge. So this was actually a piece of visual art that was created by a student in Seattle, and it says, when you want something, don't wait, debate. And he came up with that. And so this is a Teen Life Center program that we had. And And we did a lot of work around this and double participation and the number of people who were debating. We created the album. The first song was in a makeshift recording studio, University of Washington. Then I came to South Bronx, met Martha, and said, New York has to be my home. And thank goodness, because this is where it's at. And I don't know why that's turning out so funny. Well, I know, right? Well, that's in mind, it actually looks okay. It says Hip Hop Debate at the first annual Columbia Debate Institute at Teachers College, Columbia University, June 28th through August 25th, 2012. Sponsored by the Institute for Urban and Minority Education in collaboration with New York City Urban Debate League. And I'm sorry that for some reason it's not coming up right, and I hope that it doesn't happen to any of the other slides. It might be because of...
I guess I was in Germany.
You were in Germany then, actually. Yes, you were in Germany. We had a huge crew. 40. I mean, that was 8 weeks. That was 6 weeks. 8 weeks long. 6 weeks for scholars every single day. She's like, yes. It was a lot. It was a lot. It was good though. It was good. And we had there were a lot of familiar inspirations to this, as we've already kind of talked about, from critical pedagogy and conscientization with Paulo Freire, and culturally relevant and responsive education, critical literacy, hip hop education, and I put Martha there. Clearly, the Hip Hop Education Center, Chris Hampton, shout out in the back. And we have Stovall and Morrell and our hip hop pioneers, our pedagogues as well, and so many more. And I also put revolutionary leaders. I wasn't sure where to put the slide, obviously. We have our revolutionary leaders too, and there will be a lot more on this slide, but I know I'm losing time. Two, our vision and curriculum is a commitment to supporting the brilliance of our young scholars and leaders, our powerful readers, writers, thinkers, researchers, speakers, and changemakers, a commitment to culturally relevant, fun, rigorous, and well-rounded curriculum, grounded in social justice, critical pedagogy, hip-hop, infused with literature germane to the topic this year for the country, which is that the pictures are not doing what I need them to do. It's not fading, right? Resolve, the United States federal government should substantially increase its transportation infrastructure investment in the United States. So, what'd you say? Of amnesia. Okay, right. Exactly, United States of amnesia. And toward this end, we investigated this topic, read so much about it. From transportation inequity to what was going on in Katrina, which now is even relevant today. Right? Not shocking. Amnesia. And some of the cases out there this year about Katrina and evacuation and creating transportation for that. But we don't have to just do it in a traditional way. We can remix it. We can infuse all this academic literature with our own organic knowledge. And creative media production. We had labs where we created hip-hop speeches and recorded them on GarageBand. And we documented our history daily with cameras. Students use digital media in order to have multiple platforms for their voices and ideas to change, for change to actually address a global audience, not just, everyone who's there or who's at a high school tournament. We don't have to sleep on theory, right? We talked about critical theory, social theory, political theory, feminist theories, Black, Chicana, third world, ecofeminism, queer and queer theories, post-colonialism, critical race theory, cultural studies, media literacy, postmodernism, structuralism, psychoanalysis, and more. He said POMO because we even have funny names to call them now, right? And we did this in labs and working groups. We'd read together, we'd think together, we put things together, working in a community. That's a lot, right? And taught the art of persuasion, too. We're debaters. The fundamentals of debate theory, including argument theory, brief writing, creative writing, the art of persuasion and rhetorical techniques, including your traditional three, the ethos, your ethics, your credibility, pathos, your emotional appeals, logos, logic, reason, storytelling, griots. We have an African rhetorical tradition, right? Coming in, a Creole tradition of rhythm, cadence, musicality, and movement, gestures, dance, presence, creativity. Some of these Dr. Gloria Ladson-Billings had at the beginning that she was talking about too, and how significant that was in terms of hip hop and this embodiment of these multiple rhetorical traditions. And then lots of research, secondary research methods, looking at other people's books, journals, magazines, what's out there, but also original research, because not all stories are out there in text. And so, creating research questions. What do we want to know in designing these projects? And which is how their debate cases come about. And how do we take original data, collect it? Some people did interviews to learn about how gentrification was affecting their homes, and what relationship did that have to the transportation and their parents' small business? Or an eviction notice. Things that they couldn't answer through just looking at one book. It wouldn't tell their story, but they could tell their story in conjunction with all these other materials as well that echo what they're seeing. And organizing all this information, coding them, writing them up, creating white papers, that's their cases, one of which you'll hear, that can be used to submit to an academic journal, although when Tyler and I were speaking about this earlier, he said he wanted to write something different for the English journal, something entirely, which is an academic journal, and that's pretty sweet. I'm sorry. Now you're on the hook. And for words, beats, and rhyme, too, because you're looking at that to look at the relationship between rap and nihilism earlier today. And then we also had debates to identify significant problems that aren't being addressed, advocate for addressing these issues, present possible solutions, and give reasons, examples, passion. And we had these practice debates. And like I said, what they looked like just like any other debate. And we had an incredible faculty of college instructors and graduates and people swimming from around the country to be a part of this. And if you go and look up who are the people, we had our people there, right? We had our people. And then we also had public debates. We debated for an English class here. And yes, and we also presented at Urban Word too. And we also had additional curriculum about applying to college, scholarships, employment, well-being. We had guest speakers, two of whom are in the room, such as Harrell, Chris Emden, DJ Static. He held it down the ones and twos during our award ceremony. Old Barry created a video and taped it. We had the Crunk Feminist Collective out in Jersey. We had professors from Colorado and Cali Skype in, looking at the power of digital resources. And we had our Team Revolution, Dance Revolution, doing an amazing workshop. And now, afterwards, so what happens now? Well, we competed a little bit. And now we have, and these are bonus tracks, right? Extra bonuses. And now as a glimpse before we open for questions too, is that this is the second volume. It's after CDI, the Columbia Debate Institute, Teachers College. Shamela Jeffers is going to demonstrate something that she's put together, and that Shamela and Tyler will both be debating this coming weekend at Scranton. Only 8 teams from around the country got invited to this elite round robin. And then there's another national invitational tournament afterwards. And this in Pennsylvania. So it's really exciting. So here's a little tidbit of that. Tyler, you're gonna, you can just, can we press escape on that? So that we can get to the VLC. Because we have our DJ over here, who to produce this again, put it together, mix it together before, like what, right before this, make sure it looks good.
You can start, Shimon.
Oh, hi, I'm gonna speak about black femme and rage, pretty much.
Okay.
Guys, ready?
Yeah.
Okay. We are not free, we are liberation. Giovanni 72. What can I, a poor black woman, do to destroy America? This is a question with appropriate variations being asked in every black heart. This is one answer: I can't kill. There is one cop out. I encourage others to kill. There are no other ways. Ripped from her African homeland, a place where she was worshipped, a place where her voice was powerful, where she was seen as a queen. As she was transported to the new world, her body was exploited, raped, and beaten. She was used for sexual pleasure, and she was abused both physically and mentally. They only justified her existence as a slave, calling her a savage and being treated as property. With no place to hide or run, she embraced her faith. As the slave ship approached the new world, she thought that this was the end of her misery, but she was wrong. This was the beginning of the suffering of the black woman body, lined up into slavery and sold, compared to the other strong African men that stood beside her. She was tossed aside for pleasure, and violence against her body repeatedly happened over and over again.
I won't be compromised no more. I can't be victimized no more. I just don't sympathize no more. Now I understand. You just want to use me.
Female of her body is what set the stage for violence to occur. Her body was exploited and her labor gave birth to a commodity. Until today, black women have no material or subjectivity to show. When she screams and yells, she's considered crazy. We must stop looking at the actions of the world and take the world itself into account. Wilderson 10. At Columbia University, there was a black woman who used to stand outside the gate and yell at white Latinos and East South Asian students, staff, and faculty as they entered the university. She accused them of stealing her soul friend, selling her to slavery. She always winked at the blacks, but they didn't wink back. Besides, people said she was crazy. The violence that robbed her of her body provided the stage on which which other violence and consensual dramas can be enacted. Thus, they have to be crazy. Crazy enough to call not merely the action of the world, but the world itself into account, and account to them no less. The woman at Columbia was not demanding to be a participant in the unethical work of distribution. She was not demanding a place for capital, a piece of the pie. Rather, she was articulating translation between two things. One hand was the loss of her body, and the other was the corporeal integrity that ripped her from her body. Next. Rage is necessary to resist oppression, and the idea that we must repress our rage is a part of the same system of exploitation and oppression which confines us to the limits of the white society. The ability to express our rage health as acts as a form of self-decolonization and inspire social change as well as critical consciousness. Hooks, Bell Hooks 95. Like all profound repression, my rage unleashed makes me afraid. It forced me to turn my back on forgetfulness, call me out of my denial. A black person unashamed of her rage, using it as a catalyst to develop critical consciousness, to come for all decolonized self-actualization, had no real place in the existing social sphere. I seemed alone in understanding that I was undergoing a process of radical politicization. And self-recovery, confronting my rage, witnessing the way it moved and make me grow and change. I understand intimately that this was the potential not only to destroy, but also to construct. Now I understand rage should be a necessary aspect of resistance and struggle. Rage can act as a catalyst inspiring courageous action. By demanding that black people repress and annihilate their rage to assimilate, to reap the benefit of material privilege in a white supremacist, capitalist, patriarchal culture, white folks urges to remain complicit with their efforts to colonize, oppress, and exploit. Being in the crossroads of intersecting systems of oppression, it is not the full extent of the black female oppression, but also silencing of her rage and inability to express the grief and pain that has accumulated for the centuries of oppression and exploitation. Thus, the advocacy. Transportation assumes movement from point A to point B. Women have been transported from Queens to someone's property and now marked as crazy because she does not conform to the norms of society. Tyler and I affirm our rage at the black woman as a collective force of deconstruction of the dominant narratives of oppression. Only through our counter-hegemonic advocacy can truly democratic policies be implemented and structural impacts be solved. Framework: this round is evaluated through the range of the experience of the woman body throughout history. Only when we center these experiences through the counter-hegemonic lens can we have a chance to implement more just national policies and deconstruct systems of domination. The resolution calls for an increase in investment in transportation infrastructure in the United States, which will always be the internal link to hegemony and economy. The discussion that has silenced the role of the European transportation infrastructure has played in the displacement of the silencing of the woman body. Next, roll the ballot. We see the dim light shining at the end of the tunnel. We take the key first steps of individual action, but only by collective action can we win the oppressive battle. The ballot is a representation of coalition centering the black woman that allows us to transform a larger community, political, and economical institutions. Patricia Hill Collins, 91. African-American women have been victimized by race, gender, and class oppression, but portraying black women as solely as passive, unfortunate recipients of racial and sexual abuse stifles notation of black women can actively work to change our circumstances and bring about change in our lives. The existence of the African feminist thought suggests that there are always choices and the power to act, no matter how bleak the situation may appear, but to be viewing the world as one that can rise in the issues of individual and responsibility for bringing about change. Next, but our blackness marks us as invisible, and we refuse to continue to be silent in the names of our destroyed children, poisoned homes, and black body wasted. Lord, 07. In the cause of the silence, each draws on our own a fear of contempt to center of the sum judgment of recognition of challenge and annihilation. Black women have on the one hand always been visible, and so on the other hand have been rendered invisible through depersonalization of racism. Even within the woman movement, we had to fight and still do for very visibility, which renders the most vulnerable of our blackness. Next, we stand here as a site of political resistance, confident in our power, where our power is hip-hop. Our power is a personal, not used to dominate others, but as an example to others that what can be achieved. The Stolen Brother evidence established that it is through the exercise of power that we will be able to gather in a greater influence. The value of the advocacy comes from speaking about the power that is ignored by large segments of the population. Our methodology requires talking about power and building objectives. This methodology arises from most of the comprehensive study done in One Power. And I'm just going to do a summary of what I just read, like very shortly. Individuals have considerable potential to change social conditions. Online, Lawrence Hill's song says that your stinking resolution is no type of solution. Preventing me from freedom goes hand in hand with the resolution of this year. The fact that the resolution does not take into account of the black female body, no effective change can truly take place. Patricia Hill Collins is the head of African American Studies, and her concern deals with feminism and gender within in African-American communities. A piece of evidence that I read from her specifically says that only by empowering black women and creating collective agency can we transform political and economic institutions to the extent where my partner and I take into account of the oppressed body through our lens of black rage. We garner all the power and center it on the black female body. A piece of evidence that I have that my partner and I read does a great job in establishing that through the exercise of power that we will be able to gather greater influence. The value of our advocacy comes from speaking about power that is ignored by large segments of population.
Knowing my condition is the reason I must change. Can you hear us on this end?
Yes.
After the young lady finished, it seemed there was a conversation happening. We couldn't hear anything, so we were unclear as to what's happening.
Oh, questions and answers.
Yeah, we were just starting with the
music.
Okay, great. We're ready for you.
Okay, so let's begin with Wisconsin. Are there any questions in Wisconsin?
Questions on this end, if you do press the button.
Do you have any questions? Well, thank you so much. I wanted to say that before. Prodigy, Shamila, Jen, for a wonderful presentation. This is great because we get to see, you know, the young people doing the work. And so I think it was one of the best presentations because we get to see the young people. Wisconsin, are you ready?
Can I say one thing to that?
Yes, yes. I have both a question and a comment. Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. And I would be beside myself if I didn't speak to that final presentation. Thank you. I thought it was a brilliant paper you shared with us, and thank you for sharing. But I think a part of this whole process, when we talk about culturally relevant pedagogy and culturally sensitive teaching and learning practices, we have to also talk about how that information is shared. And so if we have only 3 minutes, then you craft your presentation to fit into that 3 minutes, because it seemed like the whole thing was rushed and I felt like I was forcing myself to listen. So the value of the information was then put in question. How important was it for me to hear everything you wanted to share with me? How important was that presentation at the end to the whole thing? And why then wasn't it given the requisite time and pace and patience that it needed to be fully communicated? So I just wanted to throw that out there just for future presentation of your work, that you allow yourself the time to present your research, because it's clear that you did the work and you should have the time to present it. All right, young lady?
Okay.
Now, Jen, you mentioned 21st century crises, and I wondered why the focus under say again?
I just wanted to speak to that really quickly. Because one thing is that they are preparing for a tournament, and at tournaments, remember when I was speaking really fast, like 450 words a minute, that's actually, she was slow compared to what oftentimes might happen in a tournament, and she knew that we had to leave time for questions and answers as well, and she's getting ready for the tournament. And so I think that the part of that is a matter of giving you a glimpse into debate as well, that there's so much information that has to be processed and in such a creative way. And so I just wanted to kind of give it up that it's something that is not a spectator sport anymore, like what we saw in the movie The Great Debaters, that it's become an elite sport in many ways. And so you see the way in which our young scholars are flipping it, though, still. And so I think that there's a lot of fast rap too up there, but still, this is that you have to squeeze in a small amount of information, a large amount of information in a small amount of time. And so that's what you're seeing is a reflection of that, as an authentic representation of what it is that our young leaders do at the tournament. If it was a public debate, it slows down.
I did feel that. In fact, I turned to a colleague right next to me and said, this is a debate presentation. I recognized it as such, and thank you for clarifying that. And I understand using this presentation as a practice for that, but I'm not sure if the objective is to use the presentation for us to get the information. I'm not sure that came across. I just wanted to say that. And maybe we have challenges with technology as well, but it just wasn't clear. But the little bit that I was able to capture in terms of hearing. I thought the research was solid and it was great, and I wanted to congratulate her on that. But I wanted to further say, if you are not in the forum where you're forced to speak at that rate, give yourself the space and time to engage those words and engage your findings so that your audience can really be brought on board. Because then again, you're speaking to a community in the know, the audience whose ears are trained to listen to debate speech. The audience who is not trained, who primarily are the audiences who need to hear that information anyways, it would fly right over their heads. So that's kind of what I'm speaking to when I say, when I bring in culturally relevant pedagogy as a part of the presentation of information. I also wanted to, my second question had to do with 21st century crises. And it's just, you know, exploring the idea of crises and the creative responses to crises and the creative responses to being in oppressive states, and that's coming. But I'm wondering if there's another way to talk about this. There's the crisis, but then there's also the reality of space out of which there are creative responses, and we're talking about responses to crises or as opposed to response to reality, in which case we're talking about the good and the bad, the things that are not so challenging and the things that are challenging. But I was wondering if you explored in your research the things that are not crisis things that also affect access.
So I think that absolutely, that, well, I'm not sure how, well, I think the first is, how do you define crisis as well? Because I think that lack of interest could be a crisis, and it may not be. It may be that someone wants to go and do something else instead. Maybe there's something else that one is interested in doing in terms of an activity. If that's what you're getting at, and or that perhaps someone is into theater. If maybe that's, like, if there's a trade-off in terms of activities, am I hearing you correctly? Because I want to make sure to answer this too.
No, maybe the word crisis connotes a certain negative or a certain fear that the community suddenly find themselves in, or that an individual find themselves in, and I'm trying to understand how you categorize the things that fall under that. As a way of understanding how you use that to then create access. And once I understand that, then I'm looking at, okay, what is a crisis, what is considered crisis and what is not.
Right, well, when we're talking about our dropout rates, right, at 50%, that's a crisis. When we talk about people are not interested in schooling, that's a crisis. When we talk about people like losing lives, that's a crisis. And that if we don't have spaces to talk about that, that's a crisis. If we don't have ways to address that's a big problem. And maybe that crisis just sounds like a loaded, packed term. That's fine. I'm more than happy to change it up. But I think that there need to be places where we're honest about what's happening in the world around us, and that where our young people, mm-hmm. or young scholars and leaders, have a chance to talk about that too.
So it's connected to the reality.
Yeah,
okay,
it's connected to the reality. Absolutely. Yes. Thank you.
Great. All right. We have a question here.
Yeah, I can come up. So, can you hear me, Wisconsin, if I speak at this volume?
We can hear you.
Okay, hey, Willie, how you doing? So, Jen, you cited a study in the Journal of Negro Education that followed 453 debaters, and I thought that was, you know, an excellent citation. But a little bit closer to home, I'm wondering if the three of you can talk about, for Prodigy and Shamela, how you see your experience in debate helping you through school. And maybe, Jen, you can talk about what you're seeing kind of across the debate league and the debaters that went through the CDI. How are you seeing them experience school, maybe differently, as a result of participating in debate?
Okay,
so you
first. Um,
debate helps with creative writing, with AP English, of course, and it also helps with global because it goes throughout the history, and I have the history of the black female and how her body has been exploited throughout the years. So it helps with global and how to actually write arguments and write essays. It's the same process, so it actually makes it easier, and I guess to understand things more. It's kind of awesome.
Alright, so first off, it helps with like vocabulary, and that we're always reading doctorate level articles and books and journals and stuff. So when you come looking at tests in our global textbooks or the SAT, that where most of these words are unrecognizable, like you can start figuring some of them out just because you've already been through so many of these different texts and you already have the research. Because like Jen said in her presentation, the other debaters that are out there, they present their arguments in a different style, right? The argument that me and Shamila and I created, it had a lot less jargon than some of the other things that are out there. So it's up to us to be able to identify and understand what all that type of vocabulary means. Because come the round, we can't spend our cross-examination like, okay, what does this word mean? 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 How does that make us look if we're not understanding anything that they're saying after you took all that time doing the argument? And two, other than creative writing, I think you kind of have more of a critical paradigm towards the world. Like, instead of regurgitation, like Jim was talking about again, you kind of remix everything that they're saying, right? So a lot of the times when my teachers give me assignments, I kind of ask them if I could do it in poetry. Because for AP English and for global, there's a lot of writing and there's a lot of things that you have to understand. So because I'm with Urban Word and I do poetry slams a lot, I felt like if I could do poetry, it would be easier for me to portray these types of arguments, right? So you start looking at things a different way. Even in math and science, like if they ask you a math problem, instead of looking at it like in one direction, you start to look at it from alternative paradigms, which allows you to better evaluate things and formulate new connections and stuff.
I've also seen a lot of movements happening out of people who've gone through, like who went through CDI. One individual established the Young Scholars Organization based on the research that he did and about how to create a successful organization for youth, by youth, but actually not just for youth, but for the community. And that's kind of interesting to look at that too. But then also being able to figure out how to move between, within, and around different discourses so anyone's comfortable at any given moment, speaking in lots of different ways with hybridity and this confidence in one's culture and being able to say, like, yes, I can speak from a genealogical perspective of the history of Latin Americans in this country. Starting with like first colonization and understand the conditions right now and realize that change can happen and we can transform those conditions. So I see a hope too and an action at the same time and community building as well because of that. We have each other's backs, I think. So, and people are, I mean, on their grind too in terms of studying for tests, college, and working with the rest of the community too, when they, you know, you always know where to go. I'm not the best math or science person, but I do know some mathematicians in high school.
Well, we only have 10 minutes left, so we have to, you know, use this time to ask some more questions. Any questions in Wisconsin?
I think we're having a little side conversation about Miss, is it Shamila Jeffers? Is that? You can tell we're quite impressed by your work here and the level of research that comes out in your essay. And I'm wondering, as a young woman, you know, I'm thinking of my nieces right now, how does that information impact you personally, not just your academics, but when you get up in the morning and you're getting dressed, when you walk on the road and you see other women of color, you're reading black feminist theories, and how does that affect you in the way you eat, in the way you walk, in the way you relate to other women, in the way you relate to young men, in the way you dress? Anything you want to share about the impact of this on your life personally? Thank you.
Me personally, it has, I would say, remixed the way I think. I'm quoting Jen, because to actually research what black women face throughout history, like through the genealogical perspective, it's like I could not or possibly could not be where I am today to actually speak about it. And to know that it's been like very ignored a lot is very, what's the word? Like it's very hard in a way. So it's just like, if I'm not here to speak about it, then how else will this information be out? So me personally, it's like, I really take it personal. So I actually enjoy what I debate about. It actually makes me feel like my voice is being heard in Jen's terms.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a follow-up question on that, because this is about debate, and I'm wondering if you two, because you're at this point very getting this really intense education and through debate, and the literacy, it separates you probably from your peers in school and in the community. Where, how does that affect you? Because I'm sure there's some pushback, and then you're going to have to debate that pushback. How does that happen for you?
In terms of not being able to do other things as well as my friends?
Well, it's your interaction with peers. Oh. Because at this point, I probably think you're unique amongst your peers. And so I know from living in the hood that there's this anti-intellectualism. And so in this kind of practice you're in, you are really upping the ante in terms of kind of the discussions you're going to be having with your friends and society at large. So what kind of beef do you get into, and how do you resolve that?
Well, at first, no, until recently, I should say, people didn't really know that I was actively involved in debate or that I had the amount of knowledge that I have now. So I was pretty much normal, so I didn't really have any problems. So up until recently, when they announced that I win these tournaments on the loudspeaker, everybody's like, oh, congratulations. I'm just, thank you, I appreciate it. And we continue on with regular school, but when I'm outside of school and I'm into debate, it's you have to transition your mind, because you can't really talk about going bowling or going ice skating next weekend. And in terms of debate, it's like you have to focus on saying this, that, and the third. How are you going to get your voice out? How is it relevant? How do you make this necessary? So with school, I don't have a problem with friends because they understand what I do. They actually think it's kind of nerdy and that I'm very I'm very book smart, I should say. And in terms of debate, it's like I need to keep going. I need to get better. I need to read more. I need to do this. I need to do that more. So it's just like I'm competing back and forth between school life, debate life, and personal media.
Okay, she throws block parties and invites debaters. I don't know about that. Beautiful ones.
And what about?
We're also what, like, someone who can't be here today, J.O. People stop him in the halls and ask him to spit his rhymes that he spit at the tournament.
That's right.
Right, and so that's different. That changes that atmosphere too.
You've
seen that, huh?
Yeah.
Like, do you want to speak on this? So.
I think he had something to say.
Well, we have 5 minutes, and we want to get more questions. We have questions here in New York.
Yeah, if anybody has a question, please.
Okay.
It's just a simple question. I was just wondering, like, how do you relay the message to your peers about everything that you're learning, and in terms of the entire program? Like, what if you have a student that wants to join the team and they're not quite at that level where they're able to articulate themselves or, you know, actually do this type of research? Do you have any type of support that'll show them how to do it? Like, how does that happen?
Can I tag in on Jen's question? There is no level, pretty much.
Yeah.
So you just speak about what you know. The research comes as you go, because it gets harder as you go, but it's like, you know what you're talking about. You just need evidence or proof of what you're saying. So there is no level. You can start off as a novice, which I did. And I pretty much sucked, because I did policy debate, and I didn't really care about what they were debating about, because they wanted to, what was that resolution? To increase drones.
And they're decreasing military and or police presence.
Yeah, I didn't care. So it was very hard for me to debate about it, so that's why I pretty much sucked. Up until last year, or the end of last school year, is when I started doing me. So I'm starting to win, and I actually like it. And back to my question.
Can I answer? I think what was important too is that we had a varying degree, a varying range of skills at the Summer Institute, for instance. And what we had were so many people who were dedicated to sit down and help work with what's your passion? What are you interested in exploring more? How can we tighten up these rhymes? How can we tighten up this work? What can I give you to read? Let's read together if we need to. So we can be at all levels. And it has to be. It has to be. Or because how else do you get to, we have juniors here, right, too.
So how important are the teaching artists that are working with these young people?
Do you want to talk about Tony here? Tony, Judy.
Yeah, we got homies. So, there's Jen here, there's Tony Hill. I read a lot of Emden's work, Dr. Ernest Morrell, like, everybody come together, whether they're like physically there or not, there's always their literature that's around. Like all of sophomore year, I was using like all of Emden's work, so I know it like in the back of my head about hip hop science education and how there's a decrease in the connection to it. And studies prove that hip hop allowed that connection to be there, and there was multiple modes and ways that you could actually incorporate it, like visually, into the school arena and stuff. So they're really important. Like without them, we wouldn't be where we are. Cause like honestly, like I thought I was nice last year, but last year I was kind of thrash, right? So, but at camp, that thanks to like Jen and Dr. Ernest Morrell and all the people who came out to help, like we had mad people coming from all over the country, right? And so now we're just like waxing people across the national circuit. Like Georgetown, we went five rounds, lost one, got to Elims. And one another Elim, now we lost later on for some messed up reasons.
Well, we have several teaching artists at the Institute, right, from Baltimore to Portland, and that's always been from the inception of Hip Hop Debate. Teaching artists were at the center, like working together with coaches. Like it's not like there's a hierarchy, it's just like we often work together. But Hip Hop Debate doesn't work without our teaching artists, with all of our artists, with all the elements involved.
Yeah, and I was gonna say something before, like, two things. One is that the students, like, a lot of time people think that when you're debating, you just go and, like, when you're on the debate team, all of a sudden you jump in and you gotta read a bunch of articles and, like, that's how it goes down. But it's really not like that. Like, one, that we use a lot less paper than you'll see a lot of other teams do. Like, they be really, like, real talk, walking around with tubs that's, like, taller than them. But we're able to like compile and produce our own knowledge. Like when people come, they're supposed to come and hypothesize their own arguments. And then from that, that's where they start working. It's not like here's evidence, you should study this and learn how that functions. So it's not supposed to be stressful for them to come into the community and try and get up to everybody else's level. It's for them to come on their own level and work through their own lenses and find partners that are compatible with them so they can produce their own knowledge too. About what, I don't know his name, but a guy said something about, I think, a misconception that people have about Shamoa's argument is that black feminism, right? So you asked her a lot of distinctive questions about her, but black femme doesn't only allow the female to identify with it, right? So the male, the queer, the core, anybody who identifies as a person or a human being at that can identify with black femme, right? Because it doesn't only impact the female, but like if a male or anybody other than a female or a woman is listening to something that's anti-patriarchal, anti-patriarchal, right? It's gonna impact them in a way because it changes your perception and the way that you're actually perceiving people. And then on the other guy, the way that person expresses, like, I think he meant to see if people in school just got, like, kind of marginalize us and push us to the side or something, but it's not really like that. Like, they may see you on the hall, amen, and be like, what's up, I heard about you or whatever, or they might think of you as smart or label you that way, but why would you get upset about that? Like, are you smart? Mm-hmm. So, like, they recognize you, but it's not like they push you to the side, like, we still chill, like, they don't jump us or nothing. But it's,
quick,
we keep it real. So.
Quick thing, I really don't know his name, but I liked his accent. But he was saying
Chris.
Okay. He made it like specific to me, right? But as Tyler was saying, it's not like it's something that's exclusionary. Like everybody can identify with it, but it's the experiences that the black female has went through throughout history that's been ignored. So it's not like we're excluding anybody from it. We're just bringing to the forefront what these black women have been actually going through, and not to say that black men are not important, it's just that our history has actually been denotated like a lot. So it's like we need to actually bring it back up and actually address these issues in debate instead of infrastructure and stuff. Oh, sorry.
And there are lots of ways in which that can be done, right? And hip hop is one of them. And so I think that's kind of the point.
I guess the question is, what university?
No, thank you. Thank you, Beauty. I think your two students are exemplifying, you know, the future. I want to be clear that I was, you know, trying to see if I could get you to talk about how it informs your life on a personal level. You know that you have that information. Do you have the same sort of conversations with your friends on the street, or does the conversation change? That's kind of what we're getting at, but it's very clear that you understand the information well, and I'm sorry I can't remember your name, young sir, but the co-curricular links that you're able to make and the fact that you're able to identify your learning and where it has direct impact and direct application in your life personally and in your life academically is just really inspiring to see. And I really hope that I'll be reading applications from both of you for the First Wave program soon. I'll sign off there.
Right here, 7:30. All right, thank you. Yeah.